Welcome to our second video on Laplace transforms. In this video, what we are going to do is look at taking the Laplace transform of exponential functions of the form e to the at, where a is just a number. At the end, we will take the Laplace transform of the exponential growth differential equation, so one we already know how to solve by hand, just to see how to start using Laplace transforms on differential equations. So that'll be a quick preview of the types of computations that we will do later. In order to compute the Laplace transform of e to the t. So let's just start with a equals 1. We will use the definition. After that, I will show you a shortcut. So let's open with the definition of the Laplace transform. We would like to take the Laplace transform of the exponential function e to the t. This is going to be an improper integral from 0 to infinity, e to the negative st, where that is always apparent in your integrand for the Laplace transform, and then we multiply that by what we are transforming, which in this case is e to the t. All right, we have the product of two exponentials. We can combine them. As we do so, let's switch this improper integral so that the top bound, which looks infinite at the moment, will replace with a number b that we then send to infinity. So we can say that this is going to be the limit as b goes to infinity of the integral from 0 to b, and then e to the negative st plus t. So we will add these two exponents in order to multiply these two expressions in our integrand, and when we do so, we can simplify it as 1 minus s times t. All right. Now we just need to anti-differentiate this. It's not too bad. So this will be the limit as b goes to infinity of 1 over 1 minus s times e to the negative, or sorry, e to the 1 minus s t. And then this is a definite integral whose bounds are 0 and b. Just check yourself for a moment. So if I differentiate this, what do I get? Well, e to the 1 minus s times t, and then that would drop down, cancel out with this fraction, so we're good. All right, let's plug in b and 0. We are going to do the limit as b goes to infinity of 1 minus s, sorry, 1 over 1 minus s, there we go, e to the 1 minus s b, and then minus 1 over 1 minus s times e to the 0, which is 1. All right, I'm going to step away in a second and let you evaluate in particular this expression. But before that, let me just make a remark, which is we are transforming a function of t into a function of s. Just be careful when you're using the definition like this, that when you start plugging in these numbers here, you plug them into t. So here, t is what we anti-differentiated with respect to. So that's why it got the b right here. And then e to the 1 minus s times 0 is why I wrote 1 right here. So just be careful not to plug into s. That's all I wanted to say. Okay, go ahead and analyze this expression here. When does this limit exist as b goes to infinity? All right, you should have deduced that s had to be less than 1. And that's because if 1 minus s is positive and b is going to infinity, this expression blows up. On the other hand, if 1 minus s is negative and b goes to infinity, then it goes to 0. S cannot be equal to 1 because of this denominator here. So what we can say is that this whole expression goes to 0 if 1 minus s is less than 0. So that's what we need in order to have convergence. And when we do, this is 0 minus 1 over 1 minus s. I think it's a little more natural to write that as 1 over s minus 1. So this is the Laplace transform, and we want to specify that the domain for s is s greater than 1. Let's find the Laplace transform of e to the t all over again. I call this the short way because it's going to avoid using the integral definition of the Laplace transform. What we're going to use instead is this identity where, given some function y of t, we have a way of computing the Laplace transform of dy dt in terms of the original Laplace transform of y. In this context, what we need to do is let y of t be e to the t. This is great because dy dt is also e to the t. That means now if I want to do the Laplace transform of dy dt on the left-hand side of this identity, what we can say is that's just the Laplace transform of e to the t. So this is this. It's going to be equal to s times the Laplace transform of e to the t minus y of 0. In this case, that means do e to the 0. All right. This is nice because we have an equation, an algebraic equation, which we can use to solve for the Laplace transform of e to the t, like solving for a variable in a traditional equation in algebra. So I would like to isolate this expression. Let me bring this over. We'll have the Laplace transform of e to the t minus s times the Laplace transform of e to the t equals negative e to the 0. That's negative 1. Okay. We are trying to isolate the Laplace transform of e to the t. So let's factor it off to the right. I'm going to write this as 1 minus s times the Laplace transform of e to the t equals negative 1. Now to isolate it, we divide both sides by 1 minus s, and we get that the Laplace transform of e to the t is negative 1 divided by 1 minus s, which, if we multiply the top and bottom by negative 1, turns into positive 1 divided by negative 1 plus s, or more naturally, s minus 1. I think this is really fun. The drawback is that we don't immediately get the domain for s. So here, I'm going to use the fact that we already solved this to say that s needs to be greater than 1 in order for this Laplace transform to exist. Okay, we are going to repeat this now in order to compute the Laplace transform of a more general expression, e to the at. So we've done the specific example, a equals 1, but let's generalize that now, and we're going to use this approach. Not just because it's faster, but also because I think this is like the spirit of using Laplace transforms, is we often use Laplace transforms and arrive at an algebra equation that we then try to solve. You'll see that when we do our differential equation example at the end. Same idea this time, except we are going to look at e to the at. That means when I set up the left-hand side of this identity, I'm going to be taking the Laplace transform of the derivative of this, which is a e to the at. Right-hand side is still the same. That's going to be s times the Laplace transform of this function, e to the at, minus y of 0, which again in this case looks like minus e to the 0 or minus 1. Here, once again, I would like for these two expressions to be essentially the same so that I can solve for them. I can combine them and isolate the expression, the Laplace transform of e to the at. In order to do that, I need to take this constant a here and move it in front. That's using the linearity property that we saw in the first video. Okay, when we do that, we get a times the Laplace transform of e to the at equals s times the Laplace transform of e to the at minus 1. Just like before, I'm going to move this over, factor out the Laplace transform. Let me go ahead and skip a step I had in the previous exercise. We can write a minus s times the Laplace transform of e to the at equals negative 1. All right, so I moved this term over and factored out the Laplace transform of e to the at at the same time. We can now isolate the Laplace transform of e to the at. It's going to look like the Laplace transform of e to the at is negative 1 over a minus s, which again can be written in a way that feels a little bit more natural as 1 over s minus a. What is the domain for s? Well, when a was 1, it was s greater than 1. So for general a, we can deduce here that it should be s greater than a. And that domain for S is something that you could explicitly find if you reverted back to the definition of the Laplace transform. I would like to wrap up this video by solving our first differential equation with the Laplace transform. Consider dy dt equals r times y, with the initial condition that when t equals 0, y equals p naught. We know the solution to this is the exponential growth model, so we can get that just with separation of variables, but let's see how to use a Laplace transform for this kind of easy first situation that we're looking at. What we're going to do is say, we don't know what the function y is. So unlike the exercises I just did where I knew what the function y was and I was trying to compute a Laplace transform, here y is supposed to be a mystery. So let's take the Laplace transform of both sides of this expression. We'll say the Laplace transform of dy dt equals the Laplace transform of r times y. Okay, the Laplace transform of dy dt, again, we don't know what y is, but we do know how to rewrite that expression in terms of the Laplace transform of the unknown function y. So this left-hand side is going to become s times the Laplace transform of y minus y of 0, which we have. On the right, using linearity, you can pull the r in front and say it's r times the Laplace transform of y. Just like we did in the previous two exercises, we are going to isolate the Laplace transform of y. So that's why I said those easy or shortcut computations, kind of in the spirit of how we use Laplace transforms. So let's move that over, move y naught over, and I'll go ahead, and let me just, actually, no, I'll just write it all out. S times the Laplace transform of y minus r times the Laplace transform of y equals y of 0, which actually, why don't I go ahead and write p naught there? Factor out the Laplace transform of y, and we get s minus r times the Laplace transform of y equals p naught. And this tells us that the Laplace transform of y is p naught over s minus r. Take a look at that and compare in particular this denominator to the second fact that we have up here. All right, p naught is a constant. So we have p naught times 1 over s minus r, which looks like the Laplace transform of e to the rt. Let me keep working to the right here. I hope it's not too crowded. This looks like p naught times the Laplace transform of e to the rt. And then using linearity again, I could bring that p naught inside and say that the Laplace transform of y, let me write it here, is the Laplace transform of p naught e to the rt. Now, I haven't said this yet as a fact about Laplace transforms, but for continuous functions, or at least piecewise continuous functions, the Laplace transform is unique. So what that means is if two functions, two continuous functions, have the same Laplace transform, they must be the same function. So y must be p naught e to the rt. In other words, in situations like this, the Laplace transform is invertible. We can undo it. So the conclusion is that y of t must be this expression, p naught e to the rt, just like we always knew.